that they had to put a man on either end with a pole, and then the two of them carried it. Yet the Hebrew says, if you want to get to the Hebrew of the text, eschol echod, one grape. Now we know that it wasn't one grape, because no grape is so big that two guys have to haul it from Canaan over the river. So, obviously, the concept of many grapes attached to one stem indicates that the Jews had an idea of composite unity. I'm suggesting that if they had that idea of composite unity, so many could be in union, it is not illogical to say that there could be three persons in unity. And finally, Deuteronomy 6:4, which is your passage, the Shema, or Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one, quoted by Jesus Christ in Mark chapter 12, and explained by him in John chapter 10, where he says, I and my Father are one, in union. He doesn't say I and my Father are the same person. As a matter of fact, what's so devastating about the passage and why it brings this all together is that in John 10:30, it says, I and my Father, we are in union. Two persons. We are in union. Composite unity. Jesus said it. We means two. Bob and I could say we are in this room. If it's just me in the room, it's I. But Jesus said, I and my Father. We are in union. And it's in the context of deity. Jesus answers it because the Jews had challenged his deity.
Jesus also said, he that hath seen me hath seen the Father. If they see you, Dr. Martin, they don't see me.
No, and I'm not suggesting that that's true, which I think is irrelevant to the point that I make. Which
well, the point is that he that hath seen me hath seen the Father. You're separating them.
All that he was doing with the analogy with you and him was pointing out that you had to use a plural verb when two subjects were involved. If he were talking about the two of you being in this room, he'd have to say we are, not I is.
I just hope that we get enough time to deal with the things you brought up, as
deal
much time as you've had to present
okay.
them.
As
deal
much time
okay.
as we
Excellent.
Have.
Excellent. Let's take 224. Are the persons of the Trinity as separate as a husband and wife?
I've tried to point out something before in this connection, and I will answer it categorically. The members of the Trinity, being of the nature of deity, transcend human experience and knowledge by infinity.
Okay, we'll accept that. That's good.
It has to.
Okay, this says one flesh. It does not say one person.
But you see, the
neither does the Trinity.
Neither does the Trinity.
Straw man again.
See, that's
why
the point.
Why do you keep arguing against what we don't believe?
You said the one in Genesis 2:24 is the same one in Deuteronomy 6:4 and has the same sense, and it doesn't have
Bob,
the same sense.
You keep accusing us.
You don't
us
have to explain that to me. I know what you're saying.
You're accusing us. Cal just pointed it out. You're accusing us of what we don't believe. We do not believe that there are three gods.
But
we believe there's only one.
You said that God, the Father, God the Son, Holy Ghost are one.
Yes.
Like a husband and wife.
No, I didn't say that.
Let's go to numbers.
I didn't say that. Oh. I quoted the...
I thought you did.
No, I'm not... This isn't fencing trying to beat okay. the point. It's trying to get to the fact of what the text itself says. It says Abraham... It says Adam and Eve were one flesh. All I'm saying is that this indicates a unity between them that is not solitary unity. There was composite unity. There were two of them who became one in union. That's all I'm saying the passage says. Now, when you go over to the other passages, Deuteronomy chapter 6, Deuteronomy 6, 4.
Numbers first.
Okay, numbers first.
What about numbers?
Eshol Echod means here is a cluster of grapes, which...
One cluster.
I'm aware of that, but I'm trying to break the point that the grapes are called in the Hebrew not cluster. They're called grape. One grape can't be. Echol Echod means one grape. So the Jews must have understood that there was a unity, a composite meaning to the word Echod. See, what you're doing is saying...
If they understood that,
yeah.
Why didn't they prepare then to serve a God who was a composite unit.
Could I ask you
sure.
a question? Why did they
answer that question?
Why did they blow it when they came out of Egypt with all the miracles that they saw, got on the other side, the Red Sea opens up, they walk through on dry land, and it's a couple of days after that that they're doing what? Would to God we were back in Egypt. They saw all these miracles. Who can understand people who can receive all the miracles and power of God and then move over across the river and want to go back to the land of Egypt to slavery again?
Are you telling us that God did not want to impress Israel with the fact that he was absolutely one or a solitary one, but that he was trying to tell Israel that he was a compound one?
No.
Between 2,000 and 6,000 times he re-emphasizes this?
No, I am not trying to interpret the mind of God or to think God's thoughts after him. I don't have the capacities. I'm trying to say that simply because the Jews didn't understand the nature of God doesn't mean that God cannot be composite, that there cannot be a person called the Father, Son, and Spirit. Bob, you and I are two persons. Nathaniel
That's right.
is the third person.
That's right.
Let me finish a second. We would be insane, the three of us, if for one minute we suggested that we could move from our concept of person into the infinity of God, who is as high above us as the heavens or the earth, and say, well, if there's three of us here and we all don't look differently, and we start using the analogy of ourselves and applying it to God, we would be taking God from the throne of heaven, bringing him down to earth, and saying, well, why don't you talk to us as Trinity? Why don't you explain yourself? And the answer would be, take off your shoes. You're on holy ground. Don't talk to me about who I am or how I am. Just believe me when I tell you that I am.
And who would give that answer?
The eternal God in Jesus Christ.
You mean Jesus Christ, let's say?
Well, Jesus Christ, the eternal God, is the one we
In
look
the Old
to.
Testament?
In the Old Testament, of course. Don't you find him there?
In your tract, you said we believe that Jesus Christ was in the Old Testament.
Look, I believe that the Lord Jesus, as the eternal Word of God, spoke to Moses from the burning bush. Because in John chapter 8, using the argument from the Old New Testament to the Old Testament, in John chapter 8, Jesus quoted the Septuagint translation, word for word. Prin Abraham genestai, ego eimi, I am. The minute he said it, they reached for rocks to kill him. I'm saying that Jesus Christ is the I am
Good.
Of the Old Testament. He is also the incarnate word in the New Testament, and Jesus Christ is also the second person in Genesis 1, Genesis 11, Isaiah 6, who is talking to the Father.
All right, when Jesus then, according to your logic, spoke out of the burning bush and said, tell them that I am hath sent you, where was the Father and the Holy Ghost at that time?
I quite frankly,